Welcome to the Fast Leader Podcast, where we uncover the leadership life hacks that help you to experience breakout performance faster and rocket to success. And now, here's your host, customer and employee engagement expert, and certified emotional intelligence practitioner, Jim Rimbaugh.
Call Center Coach develops and unites the next generation of call center leaders. Through our e-learning and community, individuals gain knowledge and skills in the six core competencies that is the blueprint that develops high-performing call center leaders. Successful supervisors do not just happen. So go to callcentercoach.com to learn more about enrollment and download your copy of the Supervisor Success Path ebook now. Okay, Fast Leader Legion, today I'm excited because we have somebody on the show today that's going to be able to help us with a strategy to unleash your glory. To some, Brad Deitzer's path has been anything but clear. A camp counselor in the East Coast for 11 summers, a stint in London at a solicitor's firm where he was known as the Great American Lawyer, a high school basketball coach, a leasing agent at a low-income apartment complex, an old-fashioned circus promoter at Ringling Brothers, a token male at an all-female PR firm, an executive at an advertising agency, to his role in developing one of the most unique consultancies in the country. Brad has been in some very interesting roles throughout his career, but the one constant is Brad's ability to help others navigate transition and chaos and achieve at levels they never before dreamed possible. In fact, it is the love of helping others to be the best that they can be that led him to create Deitzer, an innovative consulting firm focused on helping organizations and their leaders achieve clarity to drive business performance, as well as Deitzer Clarity Institute, a think tank, idea accelerator, and learning lab. Brad doesn't bring a traditional consulting mindset. Rather, he uses a high-energy, extremely creative approach to connect with leaders and teams and unlock the DNA inside both the leader and their organization. His years of research, success with clients across the globe, and approach to helping others is the focus of his new book, Leading Clarity, the breakthrough strategy to unleash people, profit, and performance. He is a big believer in thinking inside the box, and he has devised a system to help people visualize and construct their box. His work gives leaders across many industries and sized companies a replicable process to affect culture and change futures, both the leader and the people who work with and for them. Known for his unique brand of clarity and positivity in all he does, Brad's personal clarity comes from his personal relationship with his family, including his wife of more than 23 years and two loving children who are the light of his life. Brad Deitzer, are you ready to help us get over the hump?
I'm ready. Let's do it.
You know, I'm glad you're here. Now, I've given my Legion a little bit about you, but can you tell us what your current passion is so that we can get to know you even better?
Absolutely. You know, I love helping people. And I think at my heart, I'm a coach. And from the early days coaching basketball to what I get to do today is coaching leaders and helping leaders really achieve clarity and drive performance in their organizations. And my passion has all kind of been wrapped up into my new book, Leading Clarity, the breakthrough strategy to unleash people, profit, and performance. And I put my heart and soul into sharing lessons and stories and giving people insights on how they can achieve clarity.
Well, you know, and one of the things as I was going through the book that I found, you know, kind of like that underlying theme throughout it or underlying focus was really something based in positive psychology. I started seeing, you know, really, you know, originations of positive psychology throughout the entire book. So how, I mean, where did that come from for you?
I have been brought up from the time I was little to always see the sky as a blue sky. And it's from my, really stems from my grandmother who was blind and who always saw the bright side of things in the world and then has kind of passed that along. And it's an important lesson that we teach leaders all over that the positivity underlies kind of our decision-making and our ability to see different solutions as we look forward.
Well, in addition to that, you know, you start talking about that, you know, being able to know whether or not we're positive and that whole self-reflection component. I started thinking about, you know, organizations because they oftentimes take on human characteristics. And, you know, and it seems like a lot of the tools in the book that are, you know, really around self-assessments and, you know, being able to interpret self, that it may be difficult for an organization to do. So when you start thinking about humans not really being good at observing and interpreting themselves or evaluating themselves, you know, how difficult is that for them to be able to achieve clarity? I mean, what do you think about that?
it's fundamental to being able to achieve clarity. We have to be honest with ourselves and honest with the environment around us. And it's one of the things we talk about in the book. We talk about masqueraders of clarity and telling 100% of the truth. And so much of our society is about 50% of the truth. We don't want to offend people, including ourselves. And so many of the assessments in the book are really designed to help us be reflective and to think about who we are, what our environment is around us, and how we as individuals and leaders can really be honest and move forward and find the areas that we can improve on.
Well, and you know, when you start, you know, thinking that way, one of the things that we had talked about when we introduced the bio is the thinking in the box. And for most people or most organizations, innovation and creativity, creative thinking, you know, is really one of those things that you have to have as a good core competency these days, because otherwise you're going to get wiped out and go extinct fast. So, but when you start thinking about that whole creative thinking and innovation component, I think just about everybody has heard of thinking out of the box, but you know, you talk about thinking inside the box. Well, what do you mean by that?
So our research over the last several decades and our work with clients has proven that it's actually inside the box thinking that drives innovation, that drives creativity, that drives performance. And if you think about it, we talk about inside the box, outside the box. What is the box? We have this proverbial box, but we don't ever really define what it is. And when we put definition to the box and we realize that the box is a construct that we can live within, inside or outside, it helps us to begin to frame it. And so when we talk about inside the box thinking, it's about giving the leader a place in which to lead from and giving people who work for and with that leader something to hold on to. And so clarity to us is found inside that box.
Well, for me, when I see that, I also immediately went to that whole that we talked about a second ago, that positive psychology piece. So when you start thinking about appreciative inquiry, for example, you know, it really talks about finding your power core, finding what you do best. And when I started looking at the aspects of the inside the box, you know, assessment, is I started seeing and thinking about all of those things. It goes back to that positive psychology, that appreciation piece, that what is it that you do best that got you where you are? Because those are the things that are going to carry you forward.
Yeah. So think about what all the self-help books are out there today. It's fixing what's broken. It's you got to fix this. You got to lose weight. You got to look better. You got to do these things different. And we look at that and say, why? You know, how much progress are we going to really make just fixing things that are broken? And so our approach to companies and to leaders and to individuals is really based in that positive psychology, saying we do a lot of things well. And those things that we do well, let's work on building those as strengths, as even greater strengths. And we can address the deficits that we have. We can address the things that we don't do quite as well. But we don't lose sight of the things that make us who we are and make us great. And so we always try to focus on that positive side of the things we do well. And that's why creating the box and defining an organizational box is so important, because it allows us to identify those specific things that we as a company and we as leaders can help change the trajectory of our company by focusing on.
Well, and a lot of those things end up revolving around some of our behaviors, right? So I really like your behavior competency model. So you use it to help organizations identify 5 core and 5 leadership behavioral competencies that are unique to their company. But, you know, is it a problem for an organization if the 5 core behaviors for an organization and the 5 core leadership behaviors don't match at all?
Well, yeah. So we look at, when we think about an organization, we really talk about being purposeful, being intentional. And one of the most, the easiest ways to be intentional is with our people. And so we all talk about values, and values are the things that motivate us. It's the external motivations. It's the external manifestation of the organization. And the other side of values are these behaviors. And so companies today are hiring so much on knowledge, skills, and abilities. They hire the best worker, the best writer, the best welder, the best accountant. But the reality is that the best skill set doesn't always translate to the best employee. And so these behaviors become a critical piece of the organization. And so when we work with companies we encourage them to develop a set of core behaviors. And those core behaviors are something that it doesn't matter if you're the janitor, if you're the line level employee, if you're the manager or you're the leader, everyone in the organization has to live those behaviors. And they're very specific behaviors that we spell out. When we talk about being a manager and a leader, there are different behavioral characteristics that we look for and that each that is unique to each company. So we're okay that they're different because it's all part of creating the DNA of that organization and the kind of setting the behavioral expectations for the people in the organization.
Well, I also like your energy obstruction grid. And, you know, we talk about obstruction, or you talk about the obstruction being acute, overload, healthy, or an irritant. And you also have a list of what you call circuit breakers. And they are ambivalence, boredom and monotony, conflict, clutter, doubt, fear, inference, labeling, overconfidence, physical depletion, resources, and stress. You know, but a couple things that I didn't see that I often hear a lot of folks talk about are like culture, diversity, engagement. I mean, how do those fit? Because they seem like those are really powerful circuit breakers for a lot of organizations.
So you made a really interesting distinction. So culture is fundamental to how an organization functions. You know, we talk a lot and we go back to the box. You know, our box is a six-sided box, and three of the sides really are the strategic system, and three sides really form the culture system. And we're trying to create an equilibrium, a balance, so that there's a natural flow of energy. So there are natural energy flows inside an organization, but we also look with the circuit breakers as the individual flow of energy. So in leaders, we all have energy that's flowing, and there are things that we do as leaders that stop or inhibit our own energy. And I take myself for an example. So when I use this energy obstruction grid, and I try to do it every week to say, what are the things that are stopping my forward progress? And so invariably, mine are fear, inference. I always infer, well, they didn't call me back. Or, you know, we had a conversation and they sounded kind of funny. And my mind wanders to a place, and that stops my natural flow of energy as a leader. Sometimes we label. I label things as, in our political world, our society, we label things. And once we label them, we stop, we leave it. And there's more to it. And so we look at the circuit breakers as the leader, as the flow of energy through a leader, and how the individual can control their energy flow and be more productive. But your question really speaks to the organizational energy flow, and we look at those as a little bit different. And so the cultural piece of it, again, it's about alignment. It's about making sure we understand all six sides of the box, and there is that flow of energy through the organization that creates that alignment and that connectivity with the people who work inside the company.
So for me, when I started looking at, you know, this book and the way that you've constructed it and the tools that you're using and how you're essentially navigating organizations to that, you know, higher level of performance, is that it's unconventional. I mean, going back to the whole unique thing that we're using as a word, you know, as a label. But when I started looking at all of this, I'd imagine that there's a whole lot of, you know, emotion and focus and all of those things that have to happen. And one of the things that we use on the show in order to help us with that are quotes. Is there a quote or two that you like that you can share?
So one of my favorite quotes, and I think it's a quote that underlies what we do in business, is a quote from a book called The Other Wes Moore. And The Other Wes Moore is it's a really thought-provoking book. And the quote from it that I love is, "We are not products of our environment. We're products of our expectation." And I think that that's such a powerful message for leaders and for wherever we are. If there's a I think I've heard it called the story of the theory of the flea, and if you give the flea a box that's a foot high, they'll jump a foot. If you give it 2 feet, they'll jump 2 feet. So it's the expectations that we set for ourselves that define where we go, and more importantly, it's the expectations we set for our companies and our employees. That's why we set the behavioral competencies. We set expectations high because we believe, again, going back to positivity, in the power of people to achieve at that higher level.
when I started listening to what you're saying, and I started thinking about a couple different things, and, you know, being able to stretch, you know, you're talking about, you know, taking things to a different, you know, different plane of existence than you currently are within, is that, you know, oftentimes for me, talking about a circuit breaker or disruptor is I allow, you know, other people to actually, you know, hold me down. And I don't, like you said, you know, really say, okay, no, I can achieve that. I just need to try. So how does it, you know, and a lot of this stuff we're talking about individuals, you know, in order to help with that clarity. And that's really where the drive comes. It comes from a, you know, a personal core and, you know, that one individual being part of a collective, all working on that together. And that's what's moving the organization forward. But how can I prevent myself from allowing others to drag me down?
Well, you know, I think it's about a mindset. And it's about a mindset. It's about setting those expectations. And I look at the bottom of the box, which is organizational identity. But I think it translates to individuals as well. And when we know our value system and we accept who we are and the things that are important to us, and we keep coming back to this idea of we're in control of who we are. The environment around us is chaos, and it's our choice whether to be part of that swirl. I keep coming back to the foundation of that box, the foundation of our being, and tying in that positivity and saying, you know, it's up to me. My future is up to me, and being very purposeful, very intentional about it.
So I can only imagine, in order for you to get to this own, you know, type of thinking for you, you know, in this progression, we talked about all those different perspectives from the different, you know, jobs that you have had, is that I'm sure there was a lot of humps that you've had to get over in order to get to this point of, you know, a good solid foundation with where you are with Deitzer. Is that, when I think about that, you know, is there a story that you can share where we can maybe use that to help us get over the hump?
Sure. You know, I think the story for me, these humps are part of our every single day life, and we deal with ambiguity, we deal with chaos, and that's, we help our clients navigate, you know, transitions every day. So they're daily humps that we do. But for my company, I think that my favorite kind of story and my journey with this really pertains to my company. And I had a partner for many, many years, wonderful person, great guy, great partnership. But I realized after many, many years together that the partnership worked much better for him than it did for me. And I found myself giving and giving and giving and giving and giving. And I kept telling myself that it's okay. It's okay. And there came a time where I made a decision that I needed to go on my own, but I was afraid. I was really comfortable doing what I was doing. And, I made the decision to buy myself out, buy my partner's part of the business out. It was a scary time. There was a lot of risk, and my company was in a state of flux, quite honestly. And I was working with an advisor who said to me, I said, this is a lot of money. It's a lot of effort. I just don't know. And he looked at me and he said, you know what, Brad? The price of freedom is not free. And I thought that was such an important lesson that helped me get over the hump to say, you know, there's a lot of people who have paid a much, much greater price for their freedom. And my freedom to be able to create the company and the vision that I wanted, it did come at a cost. It came at a cost, a financial cost. It came at an energy cost. But what I learned was by doing what I knew was right for me, that gave me a chance to have a different future, was completely freeing in the process. So I let go of those circuit breakers and the things that were holding me back. And I really embraced the moment, and I embraced our methodologies, and I created a fundamentally different future. One that is built around the concept of clarity. And I've never looked back. And I think that accepting that sometimes we go through challenges, and those challenges are purposeful, and those challenges are there to help propel us to a different place. I think that's the thing that I got out of that lesson.
So thanks for sharing that. I, you know, as you were talking, I started thinking about some of the influences that you've had, and looking at how you essentially ended the book, you know, you talk about the Clarity Code, and it was a game. So, you know, when I started thinking about you telling that story, I started thinking about those pieces and how much, you know, you have made being able to conquer and get over some of these humps, and then also helping organizations get over this, you know, into a game. So when you think about the Clarity Code, as you were wrapping, you know, all of this up from a game perspective, do you actually take people through that game process? You know, roll the dice, you know, move one step ahead. You know, does that make it easier for them to actually go through, you know, the Clarity process?
It's not really a game. I think the message we're trying to say is that there is a process. There is a defined process that is Clarity. So Clarity is not this ambiguous kind of thing, but there is a process. And we use the metaphor of a game because people can embrace and have fun with creating their own future. And again, going back to the quote of setting our expectations, when we set that expectation of what we want to be, what is the pathway that we need to follow to achieve that? And, you know, my career started off at Ringling Brothers. And so every single day, whether it was a game or a performance, I realized that there was so many different things that we had to get over. There were so many different challenges. And then I could look at it and say, oh my gosh, there's another thing and another thing. Or I can embrace it and say, hey, this is the pathway that we're going to get through this show, this day. We're going to get to where we need to be. And so that's why we put the code at the Clarity Code at the back of the book to remind people that there's a lot of steps. There's a lot of things that we can think about. Sometimes we start it at the beginning. Sometimes we start at different points. We're not all starting from the same place, but we're all trying to get to the same place at the end. And that's Clarity.
Well, and I think for me, when I started looking at that, I'm like from an engagement perspective and you know, and talking about an energy perspective that, you know, going through the, you know, and everybody's moving to gamification. And I mean, I thought it was actually brilliant. I mean, so for me, I'm like, hey, that would make it a lot easier to go through this particular process because you see that start point, you see that journey, and you see the end point and what can come out of the end. So if you haven't made it into a game, I would definitely do that.
Well, my team knows that if I can make anything into a board game, I would do it. But what part of our exercises, all the things that we take leaders through are very tactile in nature. We do things with cards and sticky notes and colors and crayons and all different things because everything can be fun and we can make things into games. Even the most serious strategy work, we can put an element of fun into it.
Without a doubt. Okay. So, you know, talking about a lot of things going on, you talk about loving to help people, you know, you talk about, you know, the societal impacts that you're making, you know, I'm sure there's probably still some coaching in some way that goes on there that you maybe not have listed, but you got a lot of things going on. But if you were to talk about one goal, what would it be?
My personal goal is I want to share the message of Clarity with as many people as I can and help people see that they can have an intentional future, that the future just doesn't happen to them, but they can control their own future. So that's something that's a passion of mine.
And the Fast Leader Legion wishes you the very best. Now, before we move on, let's get a quick word from our sponsor. An Even Better Place to Work is an easy-to-use solution that gives you a continuous diagnostic on employee engagement along with integrated activities that will improve employee engagement and leadership skills in everyone. Using this award-winning solution is guaranteed to create motivated, productive, and loyal employees who have great work relationships with their colleagues and your customers. To learn more about An Even Better Place to Work, visit beyondmorale.com/better. All right, here we go, Fast Leader Legion. It's time for the
Hump Day Hoedown.
Okay, Brad, the Hump Day Hoedown is the part of our show where you give us good insights fast. So I'm going to ask you several questions, and your job is to give us robust yet rapid responses that are going to help us move onward and upward faster. Brad Deitzer, are you ready to hoedown?
I'm ready. Let's go.
All right. So what is holding you back from being an even better leader today?
Circuit breakers.
What is the best leadership advice you have ever received?
Life is a long road. Keep going forward. Know that you'll have places to turn to the right and left, but never look back.
What is one of your secrets that you believe contributes to your success?
Positivity, positivity, positivity.
What do you feel is one of your best tools that helps you lead in business or life?
clarity and thinking inside the box.
What would be one book that you'd recommend to our listeners? And it could be from any genre. And of course, we're going to put a link to Leading Clarity, the breakthrough strategy to unleash people, profit, and performance on your show notes page as well.
So besides Leading Clarity, I think it's Oh, the Places You Will Go by Dr. Seuss. I love that book.
Okay, Fast Leader Legion, you can find links to that and other bonus information from today's show by going to fastleader.net/Brad Deitzer. Oh, and Deitzer is spelled D-E-U-T-S-E-R. Okay, Brad, this is my last Humpty Hold on question. Imagine you were given the opportunity to go back to the age of 25, and you've been given the opportunity to take the knowledge and skills that you have now back with you, but you can't take everything back. You can only choose one. So what skill or piece of knowledge would you take back with you, and why?
I would take the fact that I can create my own success. And I think that I've learned in my career, I've lost my job twice. I have been shoveling elephant manure and outside the circus. I've been put into some really tough situations. And with the right mindset and the right determination, I understand that I can accomplish in any environment. So I take, you know, the ability to create my own success no matter what environment I'm put in as my lesson I take back.
Brad, it was an honor to spend time with you today. Can you please share at the Fast Leader Legion how they can connect with you?
Yes. Connect with me through braddeitzer.com, braddeutser.com. I'm on LinkedIn and Twitter and love to hear from people.
Brad Deitzer, thank you for sharing your knowledge and wisdom. The Fast Leader Legion honors you and thanks you for helping us get over the hump.
Thank you for joining me on the Fast Leader Show today. For recaps, links from every show, special offers, and access to download and subscribe, if you haven't already, head on over to fastleader.net so we can help you move onward and upward faster.